Grace and peace to you from God our Father, the Lord Jesus Christ. As I look out there this morning and welcome you all to worship, I can't help but hope that everybody else's clock is about 5 minutes slow and that they'll be here in a few minutes, because there are mighty few of us here this morning. But the good thing is, as Jesus reminds us, wherever two or three are gathered, there he will be in our midst. And anything that we claim in his mighty name will be done. And so this morning we claim in the mighty name of Jesus that we are reaping.
Opening hymn, which can be found on page 569,
We've a story to tell the nations.
Crush his foes before him
and strike down those who hate him.
My faithfulness and my steadfast love shall be with him, and in my name shall his horn be exalted.
I will set his hand on the sea and his right hand on the rivers.
He shall cry to me, "You are my Father, my God, and the rock of my salvation."
And I will make him the firstborn, the highest of the kings of the earth.
My steadfast love I will keep for him forever, and my covenant will stand firm for him.
I will establish his line forever, and his throne as the days of the heavens.
If his children forsake my law and do not walk according to my ordinances,
if they violate my statutes and do not keep my commandments,
then I will punish their transgressions with the rod, and their iniquity is with scourges.
But I will not remove from him my steadfast love, or be false to my faithfulness.
I will not violate my covenant, or alter the word that went forth from my lips.
Once for all I have sworn by my holiness, I will not lie to David.
His line shall endure forever, his throne as long as the sun before him.
Like the moon, it shall be established forever. It shall stand firm while the skies endure. My friends, as we have just seen in that Psalter reading, God is always true and faithful to his promises and his covenants. And he has made a promise to provide for all of his children, all their daily needs, when they just lean into him and trust in his mighty word. Friends, I have tested that promise this week, and he has met all my needs. If he has met yours as well, I'd like to invite you to join me this morning as we give back to a good and gracious God of our tithes and of our offerings. beautiful reminder today that God is all-powerful, almighty, all-knowing, all-seeing, and all-capable to meet every need that we might have. I remind you again this Sunday that we have come here not of necessarily our own power, but at the movement of the Holy Spirit. We have walked through those doors as individual children of God, but we have sat down in this holy space as the one body of Christ. Therefore, I would like to invite you, in keeping with that spirit, if you have gotten a prayer request or if you've got a praise report, to bring it forth and let us, as the one body of Christ, lift that up to the Lord. But before I do that, I was just running ahead of myself. I just said last week I was going to change how I did this. I'd like just to ask if anybody this week is celebrating a birthday or an anniversary. Joe?
My birthday is this coming Saturday.
This coming Saturday. All right. So you got a birthday coming up Saturday?
Yes,
Ms. Ann was yesterday. So we are so mightily thankful that God has continued to bless you with another year of service in His kingdom. What you got, young Mr. Pearson?
Daddy.
Oh.
And Calvin.
Daddy and Calvin both had a birthday? Okay, so you had a party Saturday, and Wednesday will be the birthday. Well, thank you for that.
Saturday
is birthdays. Okay, well, thank goodness that God already got it straight. Whitley wants to make sure we got it straight, Whitley. We did it. All right, any others? All right, Ms. Hill. Father, once again, you have called your people together here. We're so thankful for the opportunity to be in your holy house this morning, to praise your mighty name, and to give you all the honor, all the praise, and all the glory that you are due. But God, if we were honest with ourselves and we had discerned your call correctly, there's another reason that you have gathered us here this morning. Lord, in addition to praising your mighty name, you have called us here to equip us as your hands and feet, to equip us as your saints, to carry that prophetic message of the word of the gospel of Jesus Christ and to carry that to a world that needs to hear it now more than ever. God, we're so thankful that you have called us and you entrust us with that mission. But Lord, as we have cried out to you already this morning, we are ill-equipped, Lord, and we do lack the skills to be adequate prophets here in this day and time. But Lord, we know that if you show us the path and you teach us what we need to know, that we can go forth from here and we can be faithful servants of yours, that we can speak the prophetic gospel, Lord. And yes, we might not do it perfectly every time, but we know that through that on-the-job apprenticeship that you will equip us with everything we need to be your servant. And so God, as we have been talking about your holy prophets, we recognize that the path of the prophet is not always an easy one. Lord, the path of the prophet will lead through dark valleys. There will be trial and tribulation. Lord, there will be dangers. And the path of your people are no different, since we are called to speak that word of hope to this world that does not necessarily want to hear it. Lord, you know the trials that we face. You know the persecutions we face. You've heard the cries of your people this morning. Lord, you know the ills that befall us, for we have lifted them up to you this morning. But God, we have these needs weighed down deep in our hearts that we can't even put words to. And so we know that you will handle those as well. So God, your prophets this morning call out to you. Handle each and every situation as only you can. And yes, in our humanness, we ask for you to do that a certain way. But God, if that's not your will to match our will, Lord, we just ask that you handle it as only you can. And in the end, that you make it count for our good and for your glory. We pray all that in the mighty name this morning of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who taught us as his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
You know, I think I told y'all one time that I like to come out here and preach because I like to be on the floor with you because I'm no better than you. But really, the truth of the matter is, the further you guys sit back in the church, the closer I need to get to you. So I come out here and get a little closer to you. Let me ask you a question, my dear friends. I'm sure this has happened to many of us, and even our young folks like Caitlin and Annie. You're someplace new. You're meeting somebody new for the first time, and they stick their hand out, you meet their grasp, you shake their hand, and that profound yet simple question utters forth from their mouth. So what is it that you do? What is it that you do? When faced with that question, we often fall back and define ourselves by what we do when we're asked to introduce ourselves. But what if we were shaped less by what we do and shaped more by how we do it? Perhaps like the prophet Amos, we could prosper in what we do and become better at what we do through a little bit of on-the-job training. I want to share with you the Word of God this morning. It comes to us from the book of Amos, chapter 7, beginning in the 7th verse, where we hear these words from the prophet. He says, This is what he showed me. The Lord was standing by a wall that had been built true to plumb, with a plumb line in his hand. And the Lord asked me, What do you see, Amos? A plumb line, I replied. Then the Lord said, Look, I'm setting a plumb line among my people in Israel. I will spare them no longer. The high places of Isaac will be destroyed, and the sanctuaries of Israel will be ruined. With my sword I will rise against the house of Jeroboam. Then Amaziah, the priest of Bethel, sent a message to Jeroboam, king of Israel. Amos is raising a conspiracy against you in the very heart of Israel. The land cannot bear all of his For this is what Amos is saying. Jeroboam will die by the sword, and Israel will surely go into exile away from their native land. Then Amaziah said to Amos, "Get out, you seer. Go back to the land of Judah. Earn your bread there and do your prophesying there. Do not prophesy anymore in Bethel, because this is the king's sanctuary and the temple of the kingdom." Amos answered Amaziah, "I was neither a prophet nor the son of a prophet, but I was a shepherd, and I also took care of the sycamore and fig trees. But the Lord took me from tending the flock and said to me, 'Go prophesy among my people in Israel.'" My dear friends, this is the word of God this morning for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Folks, I think a little bit of an introduction is due. You see, I was having breakfast over at the Giant Food World earlier this week, and I saw your pastor there, and I introduced myself to him. He asked me what I did, and I told him that I did a little prophesying. And he says, "You know what, my folks over there, the good folks at North UMC, they listen to me carrying on every week, and they don't need to hear me again. Would you go and speak to those fine people on Sunday morning?" And so, here I am. My name is Amos, and I'm a not-so-famous prophet. In fact, the people who put your Bible together, they call me a minor prophet, probably because I was just an old, sorry farmer and shepherd, and I wasn't nearly as good as some of the greats in the Bible. But here I am, and I want to tell you a story about what happened to me one time. You see, I was minding my own business, tending my flocks and making sure the trees were pruned just right, and God came to me, and he says, "Man of God, I've got a job for you. I want you to go, and I want you to speak a word to that sorry, no good northern kingdom of Israel. I want you to speak against their king who is leading their people astray. I want you to tell the whole mess of them that they're going to be carried off into exile if they don't get their lives straight and they don't start doing what they should again." So, I didn't really question it. It was from God. And I go on up to this place called Bethel and I start preaching the word that God gave me. And wouldn't you know it, that the priest in the city of Bethel didn't like what I had to say. You see, he had been licking the boots of the king for so long and telling the king what he wanted to hear. And here I was speaking out against him. He comes to me. What do you think he did? That sorry, no good rascal ran me out to the king. He went and said, Jeroboam, you're never going to guess what this guy named Venus is doing. He's coming in here. He's spreading this whole pack of lies about how God is going to kill you and God is going to send all the Israelites off into exile. He said, "Well, you know what? I'm sorry I bothered you, king. This guy's nobody to worry about. I will handle this for you." And so Amaziah came back out to me and he says, "Look, we're tired of what you're trying to sell around here. Why don't you go back on down to Judah, back in the south where you belong? Why don't you earn your bread down there?" You see, he made a mistake. He thought I was a real prophet. You know, one of those guys that prophesied for money, who was a mouthpiece of the king, that I was beholden to somebody. But that wasn't me. I was just a simple farmer, really. I didn't even know what I was doing. In fact, when God called me, I had no other choice but to go and get my training on the job. I never asked for the job, but I guarantee you, if God called me to be a prophet, well, I'm going to be the best at it that I can be. Now, look around. Look at, open up your Old Testament, friends. You'll find a whole lot of prophets in there that are way better than I am. In fact, some of them are called the major prophets. You guys have heard of old Daniel and Jeremiah and Ezekiel. Man, that Ezekiel, boy, he sure can give a prophecy, can he? Isaiah. Man, even Moses. How about Elijah, man? That guy was so good, he never even died. God just picked him up in a fiery chair and took him right into heaven, still alive. So, compared to them, I'm not really anything. There's a whole lot of prophets that are better suited than me. In fact, I told that sorry old priest that. I said, "Amaziah, I'm not a prophet. Shoot, look at my dad. He's not even a prophet. I don't come from a line of prophets. You see, I'm not defined by what I'm doing here today. I'm just a simple shepherd. I'm a farmer. But I'm defined by how I do the job that God has called me here to do. I might not be from a great line of prophets, but God is going to give me exactly what I need to do to come to speak the message that He wants these people to hear. You see, I'm a man of God. I'm living my life, the life that God called me to live. And I'm getting my training right here on the job. Friends, men and women of God that are listening to my voice this morning, what about you? Are you defined by what you do? Or are you defined by how you do it? Difficult question, isn't it? But I think it's one that we need to ask ourselves. Are you defined by what it is that your hands and your feet or your mind does to make a living? Or are you defined how you use that gift that God gave you to further the cause of the gospel of Jesus Christ? In other words, when somebody comes up to you at a party or at a dinner or some other social engagement, reaches out their hand to you, shakes your hand, says, "What is it you do?" How do you answer? "I was a school teacher. I'm a pastor's wife. I'm a farmer. I work for the government. I'm a fire chief." Is that how we ask? Do we elevate our secular job and hide the fact that God has called us to kingdom work as well? How many of us, when asked that question, "What do you do?" say, "Well, I carry the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ and the love of Jesus Christ to every single person I meet." How many of us answer that question that way versus what we do to make a living? How about this? Do you fall prey to that false dichotomy that the world has put? One of the things that we're told is about this so-called separation of church and state. If you work for the government in some form of way, whether it's in the school district or in a government office, you're like, "Oh, well, I can't really talk about God. That's not legal. That's not right." Or how many of us say, "Well, I've got a secular job, but guess what? The secular world doesn't want to hear a thing about God. In fact, they're hostile to that message. And so I kind of just keep that to myself. I keep my faith a private matter." Perhaps you need some on-the-job training. Perhaps God has called each and every one of us here this morning to spread the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ, to go to tell somebody, just like we did with our opening song this morning, that they are redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ. Maybe God calls each and every one of us to do that, but yet we don't feel equipped to do it. You see, I told you last week, you remember me talking about this last week, that the world still needs to hear the prophetic word of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You see, the gospel is a prophetic word. It takes the place of God directly calling prophets like He used to. It is the good news that saves everyone if they will but receive it. And how can they receive it, Paul reminds us, if nobody goes and preaches it? You know, I can't help but think that we are greater than the sum of our parts. We are greater than our job, the thing that puts food on the table. You know what? Maybe you work for a funeral director. Maybe that's your job. But maybe God has called you to so much more through that job that you've got. Yes, maybe you repair water leaks as they come up. But maybe God has called you to use that talent to touch somebody. How might you be called, my dear friends, to do more, not necessarily to be more? How many of us have spent our lives trying to climb the ladder of success, trying to get that next promotion, trying to get the next raise, trying to get that next title or something that will give us that prestige, rather than called to do more with what we've already been given? Poor Amos. He wasn't nothing but a shepherd. That's really low on the rung in his society, but yet God took him and called him to do so much more with what he was already doing. Think about it this way. Who has God sent you to talk to that only you can touch? You see, we've all got a story. Last Sunday afternoon, we had a memorial service at our sister church, Ebenezer, for the lay leader that passed away back near Christmas time. We were just able to have a memorial service. A name that you all know well, Miss Rhonda Smith, a dear friend of Miss Margaret, got up and spoke a word of eulogy for her. And she told a story that even many in the church didn't even know, that that woman had been to prison for a second-degree murder charge. She had spent over 4 years in prison until her name was cleared. But that wasn't the end of her story. That was just the beginning. Because God used her in a mighty way through a women's prison ministry to touch other lives. How many of you think that even though you've never been to jail, never been arrested, how many of you think you could walk into a prison and speak to a prisoner with the same authority and pass the word of Jesus Christ onto them? Probably not. But Sister Margaret could. But what is your story? Who can you reach out and touch with the gospel and a prophetic word from God that I can't? You don't need any special training. You just need to be willing and obedient. And God will give you exactly what you need. He will train you while you're on the job. I'm not going to say that preparation is not important, because it is. We do need to have a certain amount of preparation for anything we do in life. Jesus reminds us that starting to build a house without counting the entire cost is a dangerous thing. It's a foolish thing. But there is such a time of such a thing as spending so much time preparing that we never get around to the actual doing. So for us, preparation is important, but so is the acting upon what God calls us to do. I want just to share just briefly a story about how I came to be right here this morning, standing before you as your pastor. Many of you probably know that I've not been to seminary. I don't have a 3-year seminary degree. That's why I don't stand up here and use big seminary words. I just preach simple gospel right from the Bible. So how did I get into ministry if I didn't go get the degree that ordained elders are supposed to have to preach the word of God? You say, I don't know where it's sold. The bishop doesn't even hardly know my name because I could not go on the regular path. Well, let me tell you how I ended up here. I went and told somebody one day that, hey, I think that God's calling me into ministry. And so they said, you know what? We want you to spend 2.5 weeks. We want you to go to White Oak up in Winsboro, South Carolina. Spend 2.5 weeks up there and go through our licensing school. We'll teach you what you need to be a licensed local pastor. And then you know what they did with me? They threw me to the wolves, y'all. They put me in some unsuspecting church in Hartsville. Two of them, as a matter of fact. Not like I couldn't screw up one of them bad enough to give me two. They said, here's your pastor, y'all. Wait a second, I don't know nothing about preaching or leading the church. Don't worry about it. You'll pick it up along the way. That was about 8 years ago, folks, and I still feel sorry for those poor two churches when I think of what I put them through as somebody that didn't have a clue what to do. Actually, I feel sorry for y'all. Because I still, every day, stumble and fall when I'm called to do the job that God gave me. But you know what? I learned how to be a preacher. I learned how to be a pastor. I learned how to hold hands and be with people and share the good news of Jesus Christ and to encourage you guys to do the same on the job. I didn't sit up at Duke Seminary for years on end and then finally decided, you know what, that pastoral work's kind of hard. I'm just going to stay up here and keep writing papers. I didn't do that. I got out and I got in the trenches and I learned on the job what it meant to be God's prophet. You see, we used to put a lot in stock in internships and apprenticeships. We didn't expect people to come to work with 25 years of experience when they're just barely out of high school. We would pick them up and we would put them in a position and we would mold them. And we would say, you know what? We'll teach you what you need to do. We will teach you what you need to know. You will learn on the job. So we as Christians this morning, I want to remind you, we work in conjunction with learning. Yes, learning is important. Preparation is important. But getting out there and doing the work that God calls us to is also important. How many of y'all have been called to share the gospel with somebody? I hope all of you. How many of you did it scare you to death the first time that you were called to do it? You've got this story, right? This gospel story, this precious gift from God. The story that changes all of creation. And you're supposed to give that to somebody. Now, you might be like, I don't know if I can do that. What if I mess up, God? If I don't tell the story right, and they don't believe it, they don't accept it, then they're going to go to hell, and that's my fault. What keeps us from going out and share that good news with you? Let me release you from this right now. Do you know that we are not called to convince people of the gospel of Jesus Christ? That's not our job. Heck, I think a lot of denominations forget that. You've got to turn right now or burn. You've got to make that decision, Joe. No. You've got to listen to me. I'm going to teach you what you need to know. You're going to have to believe me. It's not my job to make you believe. I'm called to be faithful and to give him the story. The Holy Spirit will touch his heart and convict him, and then he will have to decide for himself whether he believes or whether he rejects it. We've been talking about, for this is the second week, about everyday prophets. Do you know why I wanted to portray the prophets to you as everyday prophets? Because when we go to God's Word and we see prophets at work, we see great men of God. We see Moses leading millions of people to the promised land. We see Ezekiel speaking a word of hope to the exiles that they will return to God's promised land and it will be made into a people of God again. We see Isaiah faithfully portraying God's word to the people, and we're like, I can't do that. But in reality, prophets are just everyday people. And especially prophets like Amos. They go from where they're at, and they go to carry on the message of God, and they learn to do it on the job. If you're being called to prophetic evangelism, I just want to remind you that being a prophet is not always about these grand gestures, sweeping proclamations, or even expansive public titles. You don't need to be a pastor or a priest or an evangelist or whatever title the world wants to give you. You see, that is the simple idea behind being an everyday prophet. Speaking a prophetic word in today's world might just be more about a willing, humble disposition than it is a lofty title or all this training and schooling for the job. Being faithful in our daily labors, the jobs that we've already been called to do, the jobs where we cultivate these relationships with people around us, where people come to trust us because they know we have their best interests at heart, and a healthy dose of on-the-job training. Folks, that's what makes us everyday prophets. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Dear friends, as people of God who regularly acknowledge what we believe, let us join our voices together as we reaffirm our faith this morning. If you don't know the Apostles' Creed by heart, you can find it on page 881 of your hymn book. I believe in God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and of life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated, my friends. Ms. Ellen, I think you got a couple of youngins today.
All right.
Always have something to eat. Can we do that? I think
most precious Heavenly Father, the things that you've done for us amaze me constantly. And one of the greatest gifts that you gave us would be these precious children. Lord, remind us that we are who they love after, and help us to be good enough so that they will grow up and have good productive lives. Thank you, Lord, for the seeds. Thank you for the food. Thank you for all your blessings. And please bless and keep these precious children safe to you. We ask this in the precious name of Jesus.
As the children are picking out their treats, I just remind you that we are a busy and a vibrant church. We've had a little season of slumber as we came through the pandemic, but now we are starting to get back into the flow of things. We've got some mission projects going on. Sunday school's classes are restarting. So I just want to offer you the opportunity, if there's anything going on in the life of the church that you need us to know about, let us know about it right now. Ms. Rose?
Get organized about the same idea. Everybody will be notified by cards for them. We start in September.
Okay.
The Sunday school class that I am voting today, we are starting with that on August 8th.
Mm-hmm.
And we appreciate everybody that is interested to come and join.
Right. So the Sunday school, Ms. Rose's Sunday school class is restarting on August 8th. She issues a hearty welcome to anybody that wants to come and join her there. We are going to be in discussion about restarting the nursery here soon, as well as our children's ministries. And it's Sunday Monday, we'll be starting in September. We are planning on, here very soon, starting on a mission project for Ms. Diane Jackson, that Front Porch Project. And as soon as we have a date to start that project, I'll let everybody else know. Any other announcements for the good of the church this morning? None? All right, Pearson said there's no more announcements this morning. So I would like to invite you, when we lean on God's amazing grace, He will equip us for His work through on-the-job training. So let us join our voices together as we sing our closing hymn today, Amazing Grace, found on page 378. And I believe in your bulletins it should have verses 1, 2, 3, and verse 6. Methodist. We like to hold to that 1 o'clock or that 1 hour spot. Dear friends, I hope you enjoyed that special visit you had. You know, I know you've been getting tired of hearing me as your preacher talk, and so I'm glad that you welcomed the prophet Amos in amongst you today. And boy, he sure had a good message for you, didn't he? You know, even Amos, the lowly shepherd, was called to mighty things by God. He wasn't called to be something he wasn't. He was called to be a shepherd, but to be a better shepherd carrying a special message. That's what he calls us to do. Treasure that into your heart today. Carry that gospel news out to anybody who will listen and even those who won't. I bid you to go forth in peace. May the grace of God, the love of Jesus Christ, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen.
Hey folks, remember to click the subscribe button below and ring the bell to be notified when we post new content. And as always, if today's video touched you in some way, please hit the thumbs up button and leave us a comment. We love to hear how our content impacts your walk with Jesus Christ. Until next time, God bless.